is Sky News Business, Australia's business channel. The information featured in this program is general in nature and therefore should not be relied upon. Guests appearing on the program may have commercial arrangements with some of the companies mentioned. Before making any investment, insurance or financial planning decisions, you should consult a licensed professional who can advise whether your decision is appropriate for you.
Good evening and welcome to Your Money, Your Call. I'm Chris Gray. On tonight's property edition of Your Money, Your Call, what's happening to our property market around Australia? Some areas are flat, others are falling, and some are even rising. Where's the best place for you to be right now, and what's the outlook for the future? Also on tonight's show, making investment decisions based on tax deductibility. Should it be the first thing to consider, or perhaps the last? With many people starting to prepare their annual tax returns, what expenses can you include and what will get you in trouble with the ATO? Now, joining us on our panel of experts tonight is Dr. Vito Mollica of Rismark International and Shakri Barbara of Property Tax Specialists. So if you've got a question about what's happening to our property markets around Australia or anything to do with accounting and tax for properties, then please give us a call on 1300 30 34 35, or if you prefer, send us an email to property@skynews.com.au. Welcome to the show and welcome to you. Shakri, we'll start off with you. From an accounting sense, how are you seeing the property market at the moment?
Chris, at the moment, it's soft. From the clients that are coming, they've all been sitting on their hands. They've been very happy with the cash flow. Everybody's been pushing their rents up. And so in terms of cash, they've been doing very well because rents are going up, but at the same time, interest rates have been fairly stable.
And I think you describe it very well, saying people are sitting on the fence. They're just not willing to make any decisions.
They don't want to make any decisions. They are very uncertain. There's a lot of things going on. Also, the banks are being tight with releasing money. And so if you've already got a few properties, it's hard for the clients to go out and get some more and revaluations. Because the market's a little soft, getting that additional value out of the existing property so that you can get some more money is a bit hard.
And what do you think are the main factors that will push people either over the fence on the good side or put them over the bad side?
Chris, for the clients that I do work for, a lot of them have a journey to go with property. And so to them, it's a great time to find the right type of properties. There's a number of segments, as you know, in the market, and they are looking for where the opportunity is to get that bargain at this point.
And that's the thing, because if you look at things purely mathematically, which us accountants like to do and take the emotion out of things, it's almost a no-brainer that if prices have softened, it's a great time to buy.
That's right.
But from an emotional perspective, it's the worst thing to do because you're out there on your own and the market and the media is not following you.
That's right. Now, a lot of the clients have had experience and they know that when the market goes soft, it's their opportunities because the market will rebound and the fundamentals are strong. Rents are going up and there isn't enough supply. And so it's an opportunity for them to advance.
Yep. Now, Vito, you've been on the show quite a few times. Welcome back. Do you want to explain to the viewers that may not have seen you before exactly what you do at Rismark?
Sure. Well, at Rismark, I'm involved in the research team, and part of my job is actually creating tools to track the performance of residential property around Australia and also to value properties around Australia. We currently value every property in Australia every week.
Which is quite a mean task.
Yes, there's over 8 million properties in Australia, so it's not an easy job.
So how are you seeing the market at the moment?
I'd have to agree. It is not going up, that's for sure. We actually released our numbers today. In 2011, we've had over 150,000 sales, and prices are down for the June month about 0.2% in seasonally adjusted terms, or 0.6% in raw terms. So we've had 6 months now of consecutive falls, but the rate of decline is actually moderating. Our biggest fall so far this year was in January, where prices fell 1.2%.
Yeah. Now, obviously, a lot of the companies that are selling shares or probably the stock market, they love saying, oh, the market's kind of dropping and it's pretty bad. In reality, how bad are those numbers?
Well, the interesting thing with property is we track, these indices measure average performance, right? So you're going to have some people that are going to perform better than it and people those that are going to perform worse. So we just try and reach a middle ground where people are going to say, okay, I think the property is good or bad. I think the consensus around the market right now is that it is weak, but I can definitely highlight some areas to you where property prices have been going up, likes of Newcastle or Gladstone in Queensland.
Yeah, and Shakri, I mean, Vito's saying obviously that some properties are going up, some people, some aren't. I guess it really depends how well you planned in the first place as to what kind of properties you bought in the first place, as to if you're more likely to be in one of those volatile markets, isn't it?
Absolutely. Where you've got, you've got the two extremes. You've got either you're holding property for the long term with growth as your objective, or cash flow properties, which will give you a lot of cash, but they may move very quickly or very hard in terms of value. Now, some of my clients have a balance of both. To work it out so that they can maintain a reasonable cash flow. You need cash just to maintain the growth properties anyway. And so if you don't have some sort of balance, it won't. But if you do have a strategy, that's the key. If you've got a strategy and you follow it, some of the clients who follow an exact strategy always advance faster than the others.
Now, Vito, you're talking about these, some are doing well, some aren't doing so well. How much can, I guess, emotions actually affect the property market? Because not everyone's looking at things like an accountant in black and white. There is emotional there. How much will that change the market effectively?
Consumer confidence obviously does impact property prices, but I do believe that it is a short-term, has a short-term impact. The reason, well, there's several reasons for that. Consumer sentiment is actually very hard to measure, and it is extremely volatile. It doesn't track very well with property price performance in the long run, we've found. But in the short term, it can have some benefit or indicators. I think the better measures of confidence in a market in the short term are looking at things like how many sales are there, how long are properties staying on the market, how much are people discounting their properties from their expectations.
And if the emotions can change the property market, say just in the short term and not in the long term, how much can the media then influence that emotion? Because as you say, if there's a dozen properties that have made some money and there's a dozen that haven't, it's very easy for the media to choose, well, do we want stories on positive or do we want negative or do we give a balance?
Well, the media is definitely making it difficult for those that are investing in property because they will hesitate. But I think you should rely on the numbers. Sure, there is an extent of emotion, but that emotion really affects how much extra you're going to pay or how much extra you don't want to pay. And in the end, there is a fair market value, and the seller of a property typically will tell you that or knows the value of their home. So buyers have to come to an agreement, and I think, you know, dealing with real estate agents, you can get a better gauge as to what emotion there is in the market.
Now, Shakri, obviously people need to learn to analyse a lot of these numbers, and one way to do it is obviously shows like this. Another way is obviously the property seminars. When I started at 22, there's no seminars, there's no books. Now there's a whole plethora of them. There's all the TV shows as well. Yeah. With the seminars, do you believe that is a good way to get educated? And the second part of the question is, they don't always have a good reputation, so how do you find the get-rich ones that are kind of trying to make you millions overnight versus the ones that are much more of a university feel almost, that you are actually getting properly educated on what you need to know?
Chris, they're in the market out there, and there is a range of these offerings. And I get to see them because I get to do some tax returns for people, and they come ask for deductions when they take these things on. Now, from the range, it's always firstly, it depends what part of the journey you're on. If you're just starting out, you need some basics and you need to go and find out. And they're a good source to find out from there. But don't be just go blind and be stupid. You know, the problems have been in the past where some of these people are cross-selling property to them, but not only just general property, property that they had an interest in. That's where the problems arise. However, most of the ones that I'm aware of do give quite good service, because I presented some of these things and I sit there at the back waiting for my turn and I listen to what they're being told. It's quite informative, but it's up to the individual to educate themselves. The alternative is, of course, to leverage against the professionals, people like the buyer's agents or the tax professionals and so forth, in order to shorten the time. The whole concept is, how quickly can you learn? And nothing will take away from the experience. And experience comes with actually doing the job, practicing a number of times and having a go. But if somebody can tell you to be aware and cautious on a number of issues that they've had problems with, that certainly minimises the problems.
And so it's certainly interesting to say that you can go direct to the professionals, and obviously you then pay an hourly charge to learn from that. And so I guess the hard thing for viewers or consumers out there is, You can go to a free seminar that costs $50 or something like that, and the chances are there's something being sold at the end of it.
Yeah. The larger seminar for $3,000.
Yeah.
For the weekend.
And so, but at least if they're actually paying reasonable money to go to something, there's a chance that there's less being sold, that they're actually paying for the advice.
Yes.
And again, to go to individuals such as ourselves, then obviously there's a price associated with that. So sometimes the cheaper the course is obviously the more you're being led down another path. Whereas if you pay reasonable money or to professionals, then it's quite often should be better advice.
Yeah. Well, the question is the leverage. The professionals have the experience. They've been doing it. They're doing it every day. And they will deliver to you. If you don't have time, they will deliver to you. The alternative is you spend the time. Now, do you have the time? And the question is, what would happen if you make a mistake? How much would it cost you then? But the professionals will deliver to you because they're doing it every day and they know what's in the market.
And a quick question a lot of people ask for various services. When you go to seminars, is that a deductible cost or is it not?
Chris, the initial basis of any expense to be deductible is it has to be matched against the revenue. So initially you have to have rental income coming in as a stream of income to match the expense against. Now, if you do have it and you do incur those expenses, then a proportion, most of those seminars cover a gambit of things, but mostly they cover how to buy property, how to create wealth through additional property and so forth. But only a proportion of that seminar will cover how to improve your rental returns, how to manage the agents, how to manage the trade professionals, how to manage everything to do with increasing your rent. That portion is allowed as a tax deduction against the rental income. And you can apportion that based on the number of topics or on the time that is spent in the seminar.
Sure. So if you're a first home buyer, you've never bought property, the chances are nothing will really be deductible.
Nothing is deductible.
But if you've already got properties, the proportion of the course that is improving those properties,
yes,
and getting you to get more revenue is more likely to be deductible.
It has to match against the
rest
the revenue,
of its
yeah.
capital cost.
Yep.
So, but I guess the other question is from a wealth creation perspective, does it really matter if it's deductible or not? If they're teaching you to make money, who cares if it's tax deductible?
Well, that's exactly the point, Chris. If you're making money, that's just part of the cost of making that money. It's a business expense, it's irrelevant. And if you're learning something and it's good, you will multiply that with every transaction.
Yep, exactly. So, personally, I don't care if things are deductible or not. If it's deductible, it's a bonus.
Yes, absolutely.
Right, Vito, let's jump into the hard figures straight away. We'll pull up the numbers on Sydney. Do you want to give us an idea of what's happening?
Sure. Well, over the last 12 months, the Sydney market has remained fairly resilient. This is different to the growth spurt that Sydney experienced between 2009 and 2010. The Sydney market last peaked in October 2010. If we separate the Sydney market into the top end, the bottom and the middle, the more affordable properties have risen by 0.7% year to date, while the top end has fallen 1.6%. Similarly, the bottom end has fallen 0.1%. We can see that houses are not as strong. Units are definitely performing much better or holding their value. So over the year, units are up 2.3% relative to houses, which are currently down 0.4%. And I really think that's an affordability issue. People, units there, you're looking at a median price of transaction of $340,000, but stepping up to $400,000 for a house in Sydney, well, you're going to have to, that's a different price level, cash flow is different, it becomes less affordable, so the unit market is really holding up the Sydney market, I think.
And to try and put some of those numbers in perspective, that say even if you take the house of dropping, say, 1.4% in a year, if you've got a $1 million property, then that's basically dropped 14 grand. For $500,000 property, it's dropped 7,000. In the grand scheme of buying things, and maybe you bought it 5 or 10 years ago, a little bump like that, does 7,000 or 1.4% really make that much difference in a whole cycle of buying property effectively?
Well, I mean, it depends. Well, if I were to lose any amount of money, I wouldn't be happy with it personally. But these are through cycle returns. They're not necessarily people that are buying and selling property year in, year out. They bought one house, held it for a year, and they sold it. It's not like equities. People are on average are holding property for about 6 years, and that actually can end up, you can stretch it out to 11 years. So there's differences. When we're talking about these numbers, we're talking about through the cycle returns, but through the cycle, people don't necessarily experience large falls.
Yep. So if you bought for 300, it's risen to 507, and it's bounced down to 500. not necessarily the end of the world, but if you bought it 507 and it's now worth 500, you might be getting slightly worried.
It's not the case for the Sydney market, but there's definitely people in Perth that will have experiencing negative equity in their market.
Yeah, and through the course of the program, we'll get to all of the capital cities around Australia, so wherever you are, we'll give you some figures. Now, we'll be back in just a minute with Tip of the Week and more questions and ideas on property.
I'm probably not your typical business traveller. The minute I leave home, all I want to do is get back to my family, to wake up beside my wife, to kiss my kids goodnight. Travelling on business can be tough, but Mantra makes it easier. Right in the city, I'm closer to getting the job done. All the facilities I need, and privacy to focus on the important things. Even when my heart is somewhere else, Mantra makes room for me.
When there's no time to steam clean, you can still bring carpets back to their best. New Vanish Power Powder removes 5 times more dirt than vacuuming alone and dries within 20 minutes for a soft, fresh clean.
New carpets.
Tick. New Vanish Power Powder. Deep clean without the steam.
Welcome back to the program. Tonight we're joined by Dr. Vito Mollica from Rismark International and Shukri Barbara from Property Tax Specialists. If you've got a question about what's happening to our property markets around Australia or anything to do with accounting and tax for properties, then give us a call on 1300 30 34 35 or send us an email to property@skynews.com.au. And now it's time for our viewer tip of the week. And this tip comes from Phil. And Phil says, do your homework. A low price is not enough. You need a location that will continue to be solid no matter what happens in the economy. The income should cover all of your expenses, both fixed and variable, as well as your mortgage. It should also cover a reserve for unknowns, which is money you put aside now for repairs you know you're going to need at some point in the future, like a new roof or a strata special levy. Now, to get your tip on the show, simply email me at property@skynews.com.au, putting Chris Gray in the subject line. And all tips that we receive will get a copy of my book, The Effortless Empire. So please ensure you include your mailing address. Now, Shukri, on the tip, we're obviously talking about the income covering all the expenses. And for those that know Robert Kiyosaki, Rich Dad Poor Dad, that was very much his thought process, was that the income should pay it. But there is an argument, though, isn't there, that sometimes positive cash flow properties may not grow in capital growth, whereas the capital growth areas quite often don't have the income. So is there one rule that says one's right, one's wrong, or does it depend on personal circumstances?
No, it totally depends on personal circumstances. You've got different markets, okay? The high value properties are usually growth properties, particularly if they're in front of water or sea coast or you know, any attractive view, they will usually rise, and you can't get a lot of rent. People buy them partly because of emotion and they're prepared to pay extra, but people who want to rent somewhere to live, they can't pay that much, a percentage equivalent. So the other properties where they're actually built for living and homes, you know, you can get more, they don't cost as much, and so your cash flow is important. They can cover most of your expenses, but frankly in Sydney I have not seen that, where you can cover both interest as well as everything else, and particularly the growth properties will cover less than the cash flow properties.
Now, Vito, you brought a graph along that we'll actually put up on the screen about kind of capital cities versus the rural areas. We've got it on the screen now. Obviously, it's hard to read. Do you want to try and explain exactly what is on that graph?
So what we've got there is really highlights the importance of location. Is it better to buy in capital cities or in rest of state markets, i.e. not capital cities? So what we've got there, the blue line there shows the capital city performance since 2006, with the figures reporting year-on-year results, while the red line shows the rest of state. And we can see that at least from December 2006, prices in the rest of state market have fallen. And that's been generally the case. We can see that in 2007, rest of state market was up 10%, while the capital city market was up nearly almost 14%. During the GFC, the capital city market fell 2.5%, but the rest of state market actually fell even more. And subsequent to the GFC, we see that capital city prices really skyrocketed 12.7% relative to the rest of state, which fell, which only rose 7.6%. So we've got a big divergence there. And I really think, you know, first home buyers grant highlighted that in the sense that people were buying in the capital cities because it's capital cities where you're going to get the growth.
Now, there's various reports in the paper and there's various different companies that report on how much property has risen in various states around Australia. Can you explain to the viewers the difference between reporting based on median prices and hedonic, which is something that RP Data and Rismark do?
Sure. Well, there's three ways you can actually measure the performance of property in terms of an index. There's median prices, repeat sales, and hedonic indices. Median price indices are the simplest to calculate. All you do is you look at all the properties that sold in one period, you calculate the median price, which is the middle price, and you do it again the next period. So you've got two middle prices and you compare the two. That's not necessarily the best way to measure the growth in a market because you're not necessarily comparing like for like. You might have properties in the first period that are all two-bedroom homes. The next period, the median price property that's sold is a three-bedroom home. So automatically you're just going to see an increase in property prices. But you're going to definitely have people that are going to say, I'm telling you that properties have not gone up. It's just a manifestation of the index construction methodology that's been used. So what repeat sales and hedonic indices try to do is detect the underlying growth that's attributed to the property market. So it controls for the fact that between periods, different areas are transacting or different types of properties or different characteristics of properties are selling. So you can really understand what is the underlying growth to property, which is what we're interested in.
And this is where, say for instance, I read something in the paper recently, I think Tamarama, which is a beachside suburb near Bondi in New South Wales, they said it may have dropped 50% or something. But that could be just one type of reporting saying that, well, all of the houses were selling at 3 million, whereas we've suddenly got all these sales at 1.5, so maybe the median price has dropped by 50%. But you've got to read into it a lot more, don't you?
Tamarama is a very small pocket of the eastern suburbs, actually. There's not many houses there. And they are very different because you've got a few streets which cover the coast, and then you set back, and there's a dramatic price drop. So if you've got one period where all of those houses on the coast are selling, and then the next period, the ones behind it are selling, you're going to see a fall. But it's not necessarily a fall for the people in the front because they haven't sold their properties.
And again, if you take it in reverse, you might get an area like Zetland that years ago was purely industrial, so there's no residential there at all. And then suddenly you get someone building for 500, then 6, and then 7. It suddenly appears as if the median price is going through the roof.
It's the reverse, exactly as you've said. You know, people in Zetland, you're buying a studio, and then all of a sudden all the properties that are 2-3 bedroom units are being sold. You'll see a dramatic increase in price. But that's not the way you should be calculating property price performance.
And we'll pull up your second graph there, because obviously if people say, oh, Sydney rises by 5%, does that guarantee that every property that was in Sydney has gone up by 5%?
Definitely not. The property price indices that anybody quotes are just a measure, an indication, their general price performance. What's interesting to look at is what has been the buy hold returns of people that have actually bought and sold a property. So what this chart does, it's a frequency chart of around 3.7 million repeat sale transactions. So that means there have been 7.4 million transactions since 1990, for which I can say, well, this person bought the property for X and sold it for Y. Let's calculate their annual compound returns and do a frequency chart of those returns. And you can see there that around 9.3% of people who sell their homes make a loss or get a zero return. Now, that some people might say, oh, that's a pretty conservative number. It actually gets even better if you see people that actually realise a loss of minus 5. That drops off to about 2.3% of people. So you can see that the downside is actually very minimal in property.
So reinforcing you've got to be doing something seriously wrong to lose money.
Absolutely. I mean, the people that are coming out and saying that property prices are going to fall 40% or 20%, okay, you can have those forecasts if you want, and I don't know how much merit there is in them, but really, how many people are going to be impacted, i.e. how many people are going to realise a loss? And we've seen that historically from 1990, it's not that many. Whereas on the flip side, you've got 38% of people making returns of 10% per annum. So you can, this reinforces the fact that the property market is stable and a good investment.
Yeah, so just to reiterate that, what we're trying to say there is if your property has gone from 507,000 to 500, fine, you've taken a loss, but if you hold on to it for another couple of years and it bounces up to 525, 550, it's almost irrelevant that it's dropped in value temporarily because you haven't sold it. And so literally only a couple of percent of people are actually physically selling, and so they're not really realizing those losses. Now we'll jump to a slightly different topic. Obviously, end of financial year last year, start of a new year now, people doing their tax returns. Shukri, what are some of the things that people should be looking out for in their tax returns at the moment?
Chris, there's a number of things right now. People who've bought or sold properties should look at their settlement sheets from their solicitors, and usually there are some adjustments for council rates, water rates and maintenance levies. They should also be taken up into their rental schedules to be allowed as a tax deduction. There's a number of other things which escapes me just at the moment, but we've got
One thing I might jump in
sure.
to start with things like travel expenses. So when people are trying to choose properties,
yes.
a lot of them say, oh, I'll buy in Queensland, I'll get a free holiday every year, go and see the sun. In yes. reality, how much can you claim, and should you be buying an investment like that?
Yes, sorry for the mental block there, but of course, a lot of people, I mean, Queensland is a large market for investment properties, and when people want to go on holidays, let's say at Christmas or Easter or any of the school holidays, they decide, well, look, okay, what I'll do is I'll try to claim a deduction for the cost of the travel while I'm there. But in fact, the tax office doesn't allow that. What they do allow is for the cost of you, for the taxi fares from where you're holidaying to the particular unit or property that you've got investments in. And so you can't really get anything as much. You cannot claim the whole of the travel expense as a deduction.
And this is the classic thing of dinner party strategy investing isn't always necessarily the right thing. So
no.
I've still got properties in the UK. If I go back for 2 weeks to go and see my properties and see my family,
yes.
I can't really try and prove to the ATO that I've gone there to purely look at my property and then go back home.
No. I mean,
you always try.
You could try. But look, literally, I mean, the ATO these days are extremely clever, as well as their new systems match everything to a T. What they do is they also compare it to what the industry averages are. So if you do have a property, for example, in Queensland, you're living in Sydney, how long does it take you to actually inspect that property? One day. So they will look at the cost of a discounted fare with any of the discount airlines, plus one day's accommodation, and that's it.
So they don't assume you're in a private jet and you're going by Rolls Royce or anything like that. So
I don't think so, no.
It's not worth the risk.
No.
Now, another thing is I've recently been renovating a block of units. I bought in with five of my other clients to take control of a block. We've gone through council, we're rendering it, we're doing glass balconies. Yeah. The reason we're doing it is because the mortar between the bricks has literally been eroded with the salt from the sea air.
Yes.
And if we don't fix it, the building's going to fall down.
Yep.
So in my eyes and the eyes of a lot of my investing clients, they would say, surely that's a repair. We raised a 30 grand special levy. Can that be deducted or is it a capital cost?
Chris, when you've got a special levy, you've always got to look at what it's being applied to. Okay. Now, generally, even with the tax office, they're always struggling, clients are always struggling with whether an expenditure is actually a repair for which you get a full deduction, or a renovation or an improvement for which it is depreciated at the 2.5% annual rate. Now, my rule of thumb is, if it's stuck on the wall or on the floor, it's part of improvements. If it is being replaced, or fixing something that's already damaged. And the tax office uses an example which I like to use, it's quite good. If you have a window and you break the glass and you're going to replace the glass, that's a repair. But if you pull the whole frame out and you put a new one in, that's an improvement. And that's fairly similar with your example of concrete cancer and the likes. The fixing up concrete cancer doesn't just come overnight. It's a major issue to do with the maintenance of the building. It's a major part of the building, and therefore rendering it is a big job. You're using new materials, and it will be an improvement, in my opinion.
And so for our main reason for doing it, we're thinking of spending 30 grand a unit, and hopefully it will improve the building value by, say, 60,000 per unit. So it's very hard to argue that I haven't done it to improve the value of the building if
sure.
I'm going to get a 60 grand valuation up.
Sure, and that's the value, and therefore it lends itself to being of a capital nature instead of a thing. You can have an argument, but then have you got the money to take on the ATO and go for a long exercise of dispute?
Yeah, so the golden rule there is you can't always have your cake and eat it, and if you want to take on the ATO, then they'll probably look at you every year, so it's not worth trying to push things. Now, next weekend, there's a property expo happening in Sydney's Darling Harbour. And property expos are a great way to see what's happening in the property market and can also help you find your own team of professional advisors. There's mortgage brokers, accountants, quarterly surveyors, valuers, developers, real estate agents, and of course, buyer's agents as well. Now, tickets are normally $18, but your money, your call viewers can get in absolutely free. You can register on the website. Just go to homebuyershow.com.au/sky and put Sky in the promotion.